Money makes the world go wrong.
How can a human being do this to his fellow human being?
It's what happens when billions are stolen from Africa's poor by their own politicians.
He gave me $15 million in cash.
Their crimes are hidden by contacts and institutions in the rich and developed nations of the West.
He was obviously bringing large amounts of cash with him on the flights. He was flying in and out of London like nobody's business.
It's January 2004. Police are called to a hotel in Marble Arch where a guest is outside his room on the fifth floor, giving away money.
He was throwing £50 notes around like confetti.
What do you mean, giving the staff?
Giving the staff money, yeah.
Just like that?
Yeah.
He just came out from the hotel room. Every staff of the hotel that was fortunate to pass along the, in front of his hotel room, was just given money.
Because he had so much?
He had so much.
The guest with the hot cash was a senior politician, a state governor from Nigeria. His arrest over time would lead police to worldwide networks set up for laundering money. Politicians in Africa would steal millions, and then people in supposedly respectable offices in London and elsewhere would bury the traces, cover them up, so they looked legitimate.
In Nigeria, state governors rule the roost. They're viewed with either awe or contempt. In Nasarawa, supporters of Aliyu Akwedoma, their former governor, are on the streets. Doma himself is at the courthouse. He's charged with stealing $100 million from state coffers. In the past decade, since their colleagues' cash giveaway at that London hotel, governors of more than half Nigeria's 36 states have faced similar charges. Doma is just the latest. Even when convicted, few go to jail. Justice, like everything else here, can be compromised.
One Nigerian observer just said to me rather ruefully, this is how we celebrate corruption.
The consequences of corruption are just around the corner. No pavements, no roads, and filth. This is the centre of the state capital, Lafia.
Everything has gone bad. All the situation, the infrastructure, that's why any infrastructure.
Yeah. This is the business district.
This is the business district. This is the business district.
Detectives from London, following up on the governor who gave away money, went to Nigeria to testify in a number of cases. It was a culture shock.
Peter gave evidence. That was a little tricky, to say the least. We had an armed escort, so we felt reasonably safe.
There were 500 security personnel looking after our welfare at the time. And there was guns everywhere, I must admit, and it was a little bit hair-raising, to say the least.
The London detectives, funded by Britain's Department for Development, had joined forces with Nigeria's newly formed anti-corruption unit. These were people who'd faced gunshots and worse in their quest to clean up Nigeria.
We ended up going after the governors, and it was very, very difficult. They were extremely powerful.
None was more powerful than the biggest target of all, James Ibori.
In the scale of corrupt governors, where would you place James Ibori, is he?
Very much on top.
James Ibori robbed Nigerian state funds of untold fortunes. But he started out here, in Ruislip, West London, working as a cashier in a hardware store. He was sacked for allowing his wife to take £200 worth of DIY material without paying.
The following year, James Ibori was arrested again, this time for using a stolen credit card. So he now had two convictions for dishonesty and was facing county court judgments for debt. It was 1991, and James Ibori fled back to Nigeria. He was broke and at rock bottom. Yet by the end of the decade, James Ibori had managed to become one of the richest and most important rulers in all Africa.
The Niger Delta should be one of the most prosperous regions on Earth. It produces billions of pounds worth of oil. While the people live in poverty, the riches are skimmed off for the elite. James Ibori fell in with Nigeria's military rulers and became governor of Delta State. His salary was just $25,000, but as leader of the elite, he was soon a wealthy man. Nuhu Ribadu set up Nigeria's anti-corruption squad. His prime target was James Ibori.
It was very clear that he was very, very rich, and he was buying companies all over. He had aeroplanes, and he had properties in South Africa, in the UK, in the US, and so on and so forth.
What's more, he was offering huge bribes.
He gave me $15 million in cash.
15 million?
15 million cash in sack, big sack. And
how big is a sack with $15 million?
A big one, a huge one.
How could you resist the temptation?
There's no difference between $100 and $10 million or $50 million. As long as it is a proceed that is genuinely earned it and it's not yours, and especially an individual who is fighting corruption.
While in office, governors in Nigeria are immune from prosecution. But at the end of Ibori's term, he was charged with corruption.
This is one of the interrogation rooms where Nigeria's politically exposed people, governors accused of corruption, have been brought. And for much of the last 10 years, the man who's been directing those interrogations and investigations is Ibrahim Lamorde.
Is there any member?
His biggest challenge, James Ibori.
We left him for last because we knew he had a lot of influence. But I think we also underestimated what was coming after his arrest.
Ibori faced 170 charges, and all were dismissed by a court in Delta State. A devastating blow for Nigeria's anti-corruption squad.
It's a guy that saved my life.
Meanwhile, Nuhu Ribadu's anti-corruption work had amassed too many enemies. They tried to kill him.
You know, to my shock and surprise, I just saw a pistol.
The car was bulletproof. It needed to be.
And the next thing was, bam, bam, bam.
On a country road, he was ambushed.
And it is a very solid bulletproof.
After a second attempt on his life, Ribadu went into exile, leaving behind a political class that was rotten, none more than James Ibori.
It was a product of this completely, you know, corrupt system, and he became like the star of the whole thing. And he was so rich and powerful.
With corruption thwarting justice inside Nigeria, 3,000 miles away, there was a breakthrough. Investigators had been following the activities of the bent African politicians, and in particular of James Ibori.
You can see huge amounts of money being transacted, transfers coming in from Nigerian companies, huge amounts of cash being paid into those accounts, and they also live an absolutely extortionate lifestyle. I mean, there was $180,000 per month being spent on a credit card, which Mr. Ibori was using, a Centurion credit card.
Every month?
Every month.
What was he buying?
Well, he was spending money like water.
One example, he should have been in Poland for a trip on behalf of his state for 16 days. He spent 2 days there. Flew back into London and then flew off to Miami and Las Vegas for the other 14 days.
He was obviously bringing large amounts of cash with him on the flights. He was flying in out of London like nobody's business, all the governors were. You never give me
your money. Ibori's £5 million house in Hampstead is now up for sale. Then there's his apartment in Abbey Road, his country pile in Dorset, and various properties around the globe. He also has luxury cars on three continents, private schools for his children, and tens of millions in assets still to be traced. For the key to it all, laundering his stolen cash, he had a bent London solicitor. The lawyer's name was Badresh Gohill, and he worked for a firm in Mayfair. The law firm, who were unaware of Gohill's crimes, had offices here, across from the Ritz.
They don't say who their clients are, but we know Gohill did work for a former president of Zambia, who was himself accused of gross corruption. More significantly, we know Gohill helped James Obori launder his millions. And for that crime, Gohill had particular expertise.
Gohill was the money laundering reporting officer for his company, so if there was any suspicions around any of the accounts from members of staff, for example, they'd have to go to him.
He's the compliance man?
That's absolutely correct, yeah.
When the police raided Gohill's office, they found plans mapping out money laundering scams, all designed to hide Ibori's funds. They were all there on computer hard drives hidden behind a fireplace. One scam described the $5 million deposit for the purchase of Ibori's latest toy, a $20 million private jet.
It went via two accounts in Switzerland, it went to from accounts in Mauritius, Germany, Luxembourg, Nigeria on four or five occasions.
It goes back to Nigeria?
It goes back and forth.
We even had a company that was incorporated in a place called Nuri in Polynesia.
Ibori's wife, his mistress and his sister have already been jailed for money laundering, along with Gohill, who got 7 years. Ibori himself will be sentenced tomorrow. But the story isn't over. Britain's Development Secretary Andrew Mitchell says his department, DFID, spent £5 million funding the investigations in London and Nigeria. It showed their commitment to rooting out corruption. Yet we found one branch of his department is itself allegedly embroiled in Ibori's cash laundering. 3 years ago, an Anglo-Nigerian businessman warned DFID its private enterprise arm had put millions into companies allegedly laundering James Ibori's money. Now, we've learned Nigeria's anti-corruption squad, part-funded by DFID, has launched a criminal investigation into the department's own private equity investments. It places DFID on both sides of the investigation.
I mean, that's an incredible paradox, that the same people that have funded the prosecution are the same people that have funded activities...
which are now being investigated.
Which are now being investigated.
Amid the decay of corruption, the young suffer worst.
Number three, baking soap. Number
Some of Nigeria's politicians learned to read and write in this school. Back then it had a proper roof and windows and a floor. Now, there's none of that.
Look at these schools, they are in bad shape. Look at the roads. Most of the roads are not paved.
Exactly how much James Ibori stole from his country is a matter of speculation, but one American diplomat has said it could be as much as $2 or $3 billion.
What does it make you feel about Nigeria?
It makes you feel sad and frustrated, and it also makes you angry that you want to go after these people.